speaker today are my friend, who's an incredible biohacker and more than that. But I wanted to say, when I was thinking about how do I want to introduce Dave to all of you, I asked his daughter, I said, Anna, what should I say about your dad? What's the one thing I should say about your dad? She said, he is awesome. A biohacking day, which is really cool, and I think all of you know what that word means, and certainly Dave has brought that out to the world, all the ways that we can optimize not only our brain function, our physical function, our sexual function, all the above. But anyway, I don't want to forget this part about Dave. Dave is a Silicon Valley investor and entrepreneur, a professional biohacker, and the creator of Bulletproof Coffee made with butter. He's a chairman of the Silicon Valley Health Institute and host of Bulletproof Radio, a nationally syndicated show and number one ranked podcast with 8 million downloads.
I mean, 16 million, sorry.
I know, this is like December. No, 63. He has been featured on the Today Show, Nightline, and CNN, and in Financial Times, Rolling Stone, Men's Health, Vogue, Marie Claire, Forbes, and dozens more. He lives in Victoria, British Columbia, and Seattle, Washington. And again, it's so great to have you here.
It's not every day you get to be introduced by someone who's like 30.
I love you, Dave.
And my assistant today is Anna. So if there's something in particular that you need, you can ask her, and she'll probably give you some Bulletproof Coffee, which is very, very helpful. And when it comes time to signing books, I'm sure that she'll be handling pencils and things like that. So, and if you'd like to grab a seat where your backpack is, you can do that.
Okay.
The other thing that Robyn did mention is that I'm a native New Mexican. I was born in Albuquerque, went to El Dorado High for 2 years. My father grew up in Española. And he was there, I think at the time he was probably one of the only white families there because they couldn't afford to live in Los Alamos where my grandparents worked because they met on the Manhattan Project. So I grew up eating green chili and going gold panning on the Rio Grande and things like that. So I'm always happy to come back and eat green chili and get to see where lots of my family's from. The other half of the family's from the Roswell side of the state, which is really just Texas, let's face it. So, and before we get into the real biohacking, there's another thing I want to talk about, because I've lived in California for a very long time. And so there's a story that's famous in my family. There's a bar in, actually, Santa Fe. It goes way back. And there's a Texan and a Californian and a New Mexican at the bar. And the Texan, as they're prone to do, gets a shot of tequila, slams it back and throws the glass down on the ground and says, in Texas we got so much tequila we never drink from the same glass twice. Doing that Texas drawl. And the Californian's like, oh, we're low. And then he drinks his wine and throws it down too and says, in California we got so much red wine we never drink from the same glass twice. So the New Mexican, being New Mexican, he pulls out his gun and he shoots them both. Says, in Santa Fe we have so many Texans and Californians we never drink with the same ones twice. You have to make fun of Texans, it's a requirement when you're in Mexico. Yeah. I have family in Texas too, so I'm a C-Bob. And thank you all for coming out tonight to hear about biohacking. And I literally, about 12 minutes ago, got off a table where Robyn was sticking needles full of old blood into me. So we just did platelet-rich plasma on my knees and took the leftovers and stuck them in my face. I didn't really need it.
You look 10 years younger already.
I'm feeling like I'm 12. My voice is cracking already. But it's so the entire day I've been like one after another of these kind of treatments, because the things that Robyn's doing here are oftentimes things that the average person has never heard of. They have no idea that they have this level of control of their biology. And if I had known this when I was 20, or when I was living in a moldy basement in Albuquerque without knowing it, it had been flooded before we even bought the house. And I had all the symptoms of toxic mold exposure as a kid, which helped me to become a thriving 300-pound, 23-year-old. and to have like stretch marks all over the place and things like that. But if we had known, and a lot of the stuff that we do today, people knew about it back then, but the medical profession was actively hostile to it. And part of biohacking now is just telling people, you know what, screw that perspective. There are so many people doing so many things that give you control of your own biology right now that honestly, there will never be double-blind studies for all of those things. And that's okay, because there's this other kind of knowledge we have called clinical practice. And this is what happens when healers and doctors and other types of medical professionals work with people. They would say, this ought to work, this is low risk, we're going to work with our patients to do this. And when we observe things, we're going to do that scientific thing where you observe, make a hypothesis, you test the hypothesis, and if it works, you keep doing it. Oh my God, it's like a revolution. Except I think we discovered that like 2,000 years ago or something. So why we have this weird dichotomy, I don't quite understand. But I can tell you that personally, I spent $300,000 in about 15 years struggling because this kind of stuff isn't that accessible. So I decided it would make a really good thing, or be a really good thing, to make it more accessible. So when people using things like the internet just talk and say, you know what, this worked for me. And enough people say this worked for me, it gets to be really hard for someone out to sell some drugs, say a pharmaceutical company, to say this is the only path. There's nothing wrong with pharmaceutical substances. They can save your life. Right? If you have a blood infection, I highly recommend you use some antibiotics because you're gonna die in about 24 hours. Like, it's okay, your leg is broken, you might want a painkiller. Like, it's totally okay. Right? Rattlesnake bites you, you might want to go to the ER. So we've also developed a mistrust of those things, and on that side of things, there are people who say, I'll never use a pharmaceutical drug again. And that's also just as dogmatic as the person who says, you know what, all that alternative medicine stuff doesn't work. The only thing that matters is burning and cutting. So either of those perspectives is basically a religious perspective, and it's anti-science. Whether you're on one side or the other, it doesn't matter. The bottom line is, this crazy thing is called doing what works. And you can look at risk, and you can look at reward. And the truth is that what works for you may not work for you. And it doesn't mean it doesn't work. It doesn't mean it's good or bad. It means, oh my God, like, I just will point out something. You're a woman and you're a man. Like, there might be differences. There might be some other genetic differences too, unless you guys are like some fraternal twin thing, right? So that kind of thing, it's true for all of us. And now we're finally learning this. We're learning about epigenetics too, where even if you have two people with identical genes, the environment that they're raised in, the environment that they're in, changes the expression of those genes. And that's something that was the topic of my first book, The Better Baby Book, about pregnancy, and it's something that we touch on in the Bulletproof Diet. It says you can control your genes just by changing what you put into your body, by changing what you eat, when you eat it, by changing the temperature of your air, by doing these little things. And before that, a lot of us were kind of taught like I was. Not specifically taught in the class, but basically like stuff just happens. Like, oh, you have a headache today? Take some Tylenol, which will probably damage your liver and reduce your glutathione levels. But just like deal with it. But there's no cause and effect. And I'll tell you right now, how many of you had a food craving today? It's your fault. You did something that caused that food craving. You probably don't know what it is, and that's okay. But it didn't just happen. Like, food cravings happen for a reason. I used to have constant food cravings all of the time. And there are a variety of reasons, but it turns out you can turn off a lot of those food cravings. In fact, you can turn off all of them when you get to the bottom of it. But when you start doing techniques like the things in the Bulletproof Diet, there's some low-hanging fruit that you can really, really take care of. And there's some other things that are just horrifying to me. As a former 300-pound guy, there's this perception that when you're fat, there's an obvious reason. It's because you're lazy. It's because you didn't try hard enough. And I used to believe that, and it's totally wrong. Now we know that trying requires willpower, and willpower is a finite resource. You can run out of willpower, no matter how superhuman you are. Trying over and over and over will wear you down eventually until you just have nothing left. And that doesn't mean you're weak, that just means you're human. So we don't want to waste that by trying things that don't work, and we don't want to waste that by resisting these food cravings. We want to use that willpower to solve the problem, to find out what caused those food cravings. And that by doing that, we can free up an enormous amount of willpower. One of the things, as a former fat person, that really, really made me mad was I could lose 25 pounds. There's a whole bunch of ways to lose 25 pounds. You want a 400 calorie liquid nasty diet that like wrecks your gut biome, it takes 25 pounds. Like if you want to lose 25 pounds to keep it off, cut off your leg. Oh, that's a very awesome number. There's lots of ways to do that. So what I've done is I didn't really lose 100 pounds. I have a problem, I lost 200 pounds, because I lost 20 pounds, gained 30, lost 30, gained 40, lost 40, gained 60, then I lost 20, then I gained, like, you bounce all over the place. And there's a reason for this. And one of the reasons for this, and some of this is in the book, and some of this is in just some recent lectures, but I thought you guys would appreciate it. It has to do with something called ghrelin, which is a hormone that causes hunger. And your ghrelin levels are set a certain way based on your body weight. You lose 20 pounds, you still have the hunger levels of someone who's 20 pounds heavier. That kind of sucks, because you will continue to eat that way, and you don't have cravings. So you're going to do what they told you, which is resist those cravings with your willpower that you're going to run out of. And then what happens? Well, here's something interesting. You can hack your ghrelin level. In order to set your ghrelin level to match your current body weight after you lost 20 pounds, you need something called ketones, ketosis. There's a lot written today in paleo and even in Atkins circles from 45 years ago about the value of going into ketosis. But this wasn't something that people understood, because going into full ketosis, where you can pee on a stick and it turns purple and you're in full fat burning mode, that takes about 4 or 5 days, very, very low carbohydrates, and most people feel really bad when they do it. The amount of ketones that you need to reset your ghrelin levels to get your body weight to match your hunger levels, it's only 0.5 on your blood. It's less ketosis than is actually considered being in ketosis. It's just way more ketosis than you were ever otherwise going to get in a natural day. If you eat carbs, and even with like normal amounts of protein like most people, you generally have 0 or 0.1 level in your blood of ketones. You'll never get to 0.5, except there's a hack for that. And that hack would be Bulletproof coffee, if you make it with brain octane oil, because brain octane oil metabolizes, and using a blood meter, I can have sushi for dinner with a pound of rice, and the next morning I shouldn't be in ketosis, but I can drink a big cup of Bulletproof coffee with, for my body weight, it takes about 2 or 3 tablespoons of brain octane. Your number may be 1/2 teaspoon, I don't know, start slow, disaster plans isn't fun. But when you do this, what happens is your blood levels can go up just to 0.5, 0.6. And when you do that, suddenly your hunger levels match your fatness level or your thinness level, depending on how you want to think about it. And that's really a cool thing. The other thing that happens at that 0.5, actually 0.3, even less, is a hormone called CCK, which is designed by Calvin Klein. And this hormone is one that makes you feel satisfied and full. So if you can get your blood levels, you're not in ketosis, you're just almost in ketosis. It's like pre-ketosis. If you can get your levels there, you're satisfied the hormone gets turned on. And this is why if you have Bulletproof coffee in the morning, you're like, I just don't care about that donut. And that's liberating. Because here's what happens in everyone's head, especially fat people who have energy problems. You set the donut here, or the bagel, or whatever it is, and the bagel calls out to you, it goes, eat me. And you're like, okay, no. Okay, there's willpower. And then the donut, which doesn't have willpower constraints, it says, eat me, and you say, no, 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 no. And eventually you go, I'll just have half. And then you go, and not only that, I had half because I'm weak, maybe because I'm a bad person, right? This is what happens in every fat person. I know this, because I did this. So, given that dynamic, what do? Turn off the voice that says, give me the donut. And for me, Bulletproof coffee has made it effortless to maintain my weight, which is really, really cool. And that means if you can turn off those cravings, all that willpower that you could have been using to like be a better parent, to do something to help other people, for your job, to repaint your house, whatever you thought was interesting, to watch more reruns, it doesn't matter. That willpower that was being wasted on the donut is now yours to use or squander. And, wow, that's kind of important. So that is one of the core reasons I wrote the Bulletproof Diet, because it's actually not a book about weight loss. Weight loss is a byproduct of having things work well. It's a book about eating to have more willpower and eating to have your brain work all day. because I did not have my brain work all day. I've been very successful in my career, and I'm really fortunate for that, but a lot of it was hanging on by the skin of my teeth because I was taking smart drugs because my brain wasn't working. I'm like, I don't know if I can really finish what I'm supposed to be doing today, or I can't even remember what I was supposed to be doing today, but I'll just put one foot in front of the other. And people who've been exposed to toxic mold or had Lyme disease or chronic fatigue syndrome or fibromyalgia, all of which I've been diagnosed with, they understand that very well. But for every person who's been diagnosed, there's dozens and dozens more people who have stuff that's wrong. Like, well, today's just a bad day. I'm just not feeling very good. I'll just like have some extra coffee. I'll just power through it. And what powering through it actually does is it makes you mean. Because when you don't have enough energy in your brain, you don't have prefrontal cortex energy. This is the part of your brain that uses the most energy. It's the part of your brain that actually controls whether you're going to act like a jerk or not. So you need to have this thing working. Your sugar goes down, and your energy metabolism doesn't work, you ate some toxins, and this part of you goes, oh, I didn't get quite enough fuel, so then you lose your ability to regulate your emotions, and then you're unkind to people that you really didn't want to be unkind to. And this could be, okay, now you said something mean to your kid, or it could be something like, oh, I just got fired, that kind of wasn't a good thing, or maybe I drove into that giant truck that cut me off, and now this guy's beating me across the head and shoulders. These things happen every day, hundreds of thousands of times, because people don't eat right. All right, I've got a couple questions. Did you have a question there, or were you just drawing? Miss Anna? Keep drawing. You're awesome.
Okay, so you're saying the protocol is not to eat food for breakfast, but to have the bulletproof coffee with the MCT oil and butter.
It's not MCT oil. It's brain octane oil. MCT oil is four kinds of oils. One of them makes you poop in your pants. One of them is not really an MCT oil because it was mislabeled. The other two, C10 and C8 are what's left. Brain octane is just C8. So it's only one of the four MCTs. If you just use plain MCT oil, you should expect to spend lots of time in the bathroom and your mileage will vary.
Okay. And then that puts you in ketosis, just the fact?
It doesn't put you in full ketosis.
Okay.
But C8 metabolizes directly to what's called beta-hydroxybutyrate and coenzyme A and then ATP.
Okay.
If you're into biochemistry, ATP is like the thing that powers your cells.
Sure.
So you will pee pink on a stick if you use brain octane oil. And you'll actually have ketones present in the blood, and your brain will benefit from that.
And then when do you break that? At lunch or dinner, or you just go as long as you can go?
Well, it turns out there's a couple different protocols in the morning. So one, and this is a new thing that like I invented, it's called bulletproof intermittent fasting. And bulletproof intermittent fasting is the idea that fasting in the morning where you eat nothing works, but it increases adrenal stress, and it doesn't give you ketones. If you use just fat with no protein and no sugar, you definitely get the ketones, but your body still thinks you're fasting because it's doing what it does during a fast, which is go into fat burning mode, ketosis. So that's a hack. But if you just wanted to have the reset, you can still have fat and protein in the morning, and you'll still probably get your ketone levels up as high, but you don't get all the other benefits of fasting. So the bottom line is brain octane is really important in the morning, and not having carbs in the morning is important. If you have carbs in the morning, it's going to set you up for this all day long. And this is something, like, it makes me mad. Check this out. Does anyone here know why Kellogg's Raisin Bran and why Corn Flakes and graham crackers were made?
Is that helping? Kellogg's.
You know?
To dampen the libido. Yes.
Damn straight. They made those foods because they thought that male desire was the source of all evil, which may or may not be true. And to solve that problem, or non-problem, depending on your perspective, we'll just make these foods that make humans weak. We'll reduce fertility of the species. It was an evil act. That's why we put skim milk on fruit and stuff in the morning to reduce our fertility. I hate to tell you, fertility is a huge marker of how healthy your body is. Because when you are not healthy enough to reproduce, like one in eight couples under 30 who can't reproduce without massive assistance, if at all, and the number's getting worse and worse and worse, this is what happens when you feed people crap. And that's what happens when you feed them carbs in the morning. Don't eat carbs in the morning. I think that makes sense. Any questions?
Yeah. Dave, since the toxic exposure, I have become allergic to coffee and including bulletproof coffee.
You're allergic to coffee?
Yeah.
Oh my God, life is over.
I've tested twice. I want to still get the benefits out of the octane.
You can still use brain octane oil without the coffee. You could try tea or chocolate or none of the above. There are benefits that come from polyphenols in your diet, which come from dark colored things like leafy greens, like red vegetables and purple berries, and coffee and chocolate, and to some extent tea. So the polyphenols are good, and they're particularly good if you're toxic. But if you can't do coffee, you can't do some other source of polyphenols, that's okay. You still can do brain octane. And brain octane has another effect that's pretty interesting. It's a very potent antifungal. So just topically, it kills yeast. You can actually use it for yeast, like candida. And I have massive problems with candida. And so, you know, if you whack the candida over the head, pretty much at every meal, like I do, I don't have candida problems anymore, but I carry a little vial of brain octane when I go out to restaurants and I pour it on my food. I did it at lunch with Robyn today. And you know what happens every time I eat? I'm actually full, and I just don't care about food until the next meal, which may come in 4 hours or 7 hours. I don't really care. My energy's always there. I don't think about it. I don't crave. I don't go, oh, cookies. I'm just going to pretend. I just don't care about the cookies. They have lost their little siren call for me. And on top of that, if there was going to be candida, like, it's not going to like being full of brain octane. So I don't have any anymore. And that's pretty amazing. I did take prescription pharmaceutical bad antifungals. They work really well when you have candida. And in fact, I don't know anyone who's really successfully killed and kept candida away without using prescription stuff, including my statin and diclofenac. There's nothing wrong with using those as long as your liver doesn't fail. Go one second.
Okay, so breakfast is fat and protein.
Yep.
What would a typical breakfast look like, since we're not talking about the typical, what we've been raised to know
what would breakfast, typical breakfast look like?
Right, if you're just doing fat and protein.
Okay. So, and I want to be really clear here, I'm at least, actually probably a little more than half the room is women. And in fact, a good number of you are possibly women over 40, but just barely, if at all. Now, if that describes you, you're probably going to want to do protein in the morning, because it's harder on your hormones, it's harder on women's bodies to do just fat in the morning. Some thrive on it, and it's better than doing nothing in the morning, but fat and protein is pretty common. So at my house, a very common breakfast like that is Bulletproof coffee with added collagen. You make a grass-fed collagen, and you're in a hurry, you don't want to be hungry for a long time. So you make the coffee, throw in the blender, throw in the butter, throw in the brain octane, throw in the collagen, you're done. But the other thing, I'll tell you a little story. Alan's five, my son, and his brother. And he, the other day, was complaining about whatever. He had smoked salmon and avocado for breakfast, and he was complaining about that. That's a common breakfast for us. Costco sells smoked salmon for really cheap, and they sell avocados for really cheap. Like, it's a good deal. And it's also quality food with good fats, and it's all protein and all that. So he said, I don't want to eat it. And so in our house, the response to that is, well, you don't have to eat. It's okay. You won't starve. It takes a whole month to starve. So we don't really snack much around here. So like, there'll be another meal. Don't worry. And Lana, my wife, Dr. Lana, she says, you know, Alan, not all mommies make breakfast for their kids. And he goes, you mean they don't even get anything for breakfast? And she says, no, they didn't get anything at all. And this is classic. He goes, no duck eggs and bacon even? So eggs, yeah, eggs are good. They're very affordable. They're a great source of fat and a good source of protein. They're also relatively allergic. I struggled greatly when I was making the Bulletproof Diet Roadmap. And if you haven't downloaded the roadmap, you need to go do that. It just tells you on one page, like, so much knowledge about what foods are going to be bulletproof. I put eggs in the bulletproof category because they're such an important source of nutrients, and they have a special kinds of fats called phospholipids. The problem is that there are people who are allergic to eggs, and so you might want to not eat eggs every day forever because your chances of becoming allergic to them go up. So you want to rotate off eggs every now and then, have some duck eggs every now and then if they're available to you. They seem like a fancy gourmet thing. I find them in farmers markets occasionally, and you're like, oh great, we've got some duck eggs. Who does?
The co-op.
The co-op here, beautiful. So, and a lot of people who are allergic to regular eggs can eat duck eggs, and you just skip eggs, you know, every 4 or 5 days. Don't have eggs that day, and you're probably fine. Most people eat eggs most of the time. And so that's a really common breakfast. So pretty much some sort of protein source, meat, eggs, protein powders, some of them are okay. I find a lot of them, though, they put junk in them. Like, a lot of them are like casein powders, milk protein isolate. They're cheap, and they're trying to make it cheap. Or my favorite thing is, plant-based protein. Plant-based protein is going to be good for you, right? My favorite plant-based protein is ricin, the nerve gas that they use. So it's always good for you. It's plant-based. It's got to be safe. And my favorite animal-based protein, by the way, is like scorpion venom, because like it's also a protein and it's animal-based. So like it's a meaningless distinction. I don't care if your protein came from plants or if it came from animals. I care about the quality of the protein, the amino acids, the absorbability. And I'll tell you, plants don't make very good protein. They actually make pretty good starch and pretty good fiber, and they're relatively poor sources of protein. And when they have lots of starch or lots of protein, they protect it really, really well. Because this is crazy, but if you're a plant, your job is not to be food. Your job is to reproduce and make more plants. Just like our job is not to be eaten by tigers, so we go out to great lengths to not be eaten by tigers. So since we can run away and kill tigers, and plants can't run away or kill cows or humans that eat them, they cover themselves in poison. This is just a natural evolutionary thing, it's okay. Some animals are better at some poison than others. Some humans are better at breaking down some animal toxins or some plant toxins than others. This is why in the middle of the Bulletproof diet, in that roadmap, the top we have Bulletproof foods, and then we have suspect foods. 20% of rheumatoid arthritis comes from eating potatoes and eggplants and bell peppers, and I hate to say it, even green chili.
Wow.
It's a nightshade, but they're sort of goji berries. So if you don't know if you're nightshade insensitive, or you don't know that, you know, you're okay with green chili, but you're not okay with bell peppers, and there's lots of people like that, and you eat bell peppers, you just get this random thing where, you know, a lot of the time my joints hurt, I don't really know why. And then 20 years from now, I have an autoimmune condition. It's because you were eating foods that were suspect that you never eliminated from the suspect list. That's why those things are there. And there's a bunch of foods. Generally, the ones in the middle have a downside and they have an upside. Generally, the ones in the Bulletproof category mostly have upside and very little downside. And the ones in the kryptonite thing, like, why would you eat those unless you were dying of starvation? And if you could afford to get the book or probably to download the free infographic, you really aren't starving to death. So from that perspective, you need to really think about it. People say, I can't afford to eat this way. It's like, no, grass-fed butter is really, really good and pretty darn affordable. It's about $3 for half a pound. And it's a lot of calories for $3, way better than a Happy Meal. Dollars per calorie, right? Eggs, pretty darn cheap. Organic eggs are nice. If you're really, really hungry, don't eat the organic eggs. You're still gonna be better off with an egg and butter than you are with Rice Krispies and Raisin Bran. In fact, on a dollar per calorie basis, you'll be better. On a dollar per I'm not hungry anymore basis, you'll be better. And on a dollar per I kick more ass today basis, you're gonna be better. So it's not about being perfect. It's just about making decisions that are a little bit better. So I do my very best to say, this is as good as I know how to get. Just go in that direction. Don't worry about being perfect. Because if you worry about being perfect, then you'll use all your willpower, your decision making on like worrying about being perfect. And that's not fun either. That's kind of the Bulletproof diet in a nutshell. Okay, any other questions?
What's your favorite grass-fed butter?
What's my favorite grass-fed butter? Well, local pastured butter or local pastured butter from someone who grew a cow in your house is always better. It's hard to get, it's expensive, and here's the problem. When you have a cow, and I know because our cows like to eat the grass from the front of my property now, but when you have a cow, if you want to get butter, you have to do something with the rest of that milk, right? So what do you do? There's only one good thing to do. You take the rest of that milk and you give it to the pigs, and they make bacon out of milk. Like, it's such a cool thing. That's actually what the permaculture farms do. Bios, like, those small local guys are actually selling all of the milk or selling cream, things like that. And there is a noticeable difference between butter and cream, both in your coffee and in your diet. There's lots of people who don't tolerate cream while they tolerate butter just fine. And people who tolerate ghee or clarified butter who don't tolerate the other just plain butter. So it's definitely kind of a spectrum there. But if I'm going to go to the grocery store, Kerrygold butter, I've recommended for years, is Irish butter. But you know what? During winter, 10% of what's in that maybe. Did they change to 20? Where did you get that number? Because I called
on their website.
Did they? Then they just recently changed that. Because what's probably my fault? Because I raised.
Well, I'm talking about Horizon. What's a?
Oh, Horizon's different. I'm talking about Kerrygold.
Kerrygold. Organic Valley.
Oh, Organic Valley.
And they both Kerrygold and Organic Valley, and what's that other one? There's one more.
Natural Supermarket.
Yeah, they all say that 20%.
Not Kerrygold, it's 10. Like I called them and talked to them. Like it's 10, and but here's the problem. I have a petition with like 10,000 signatures about this. Of that 10% of non-grass feed, up to 30% of it, another 3% of their total diet, could be genetically modified, which frankly pisses me off. Shouldn't happen, right? But to our recommendatory goal, yeah. Do you know why? Because you go to almost any grocery store in the United States and get a butter that is essentially grass-fed. It's not perfect, but it's really close to perfect, and it's $3. Right? You could also spend $9 on the local artisanal brand, which is better butter. But they oftentimes salt that too, and I don't think salted coffee is that delicious. Some people do, but the short answer is that Anchor is also really good if you can find it. It's an unusual brand. It comes from New Zealand, and I'm working on a few things to make butter way more available, like grass-fed butter, way more available to you guys. Give me a few months.
If you wanted to buy it at the end of the summer, before they start feeding it grain, can you freeze the butter? Or is
butter freezes like crazy. I live in Canada where there's a butter mafia. It's true, like one of the Italian mafia families owns the entire country's dairy quota. So it's illegal to import butter unless you pay a 300% tariff. So butter that is $3 here costs $12 there, so no one will buy it, so they don't import it. But you can import it for personal use. So I bring 100 pounds of butter in all the time. I have a whole boat with like a butter smuggling rig. And what I do is I freeze it, and you buy it in the boxes. There's 20 sticks per box. And it's wrapped in foil, and you just throw it in the freezer, and it freezes very, very well for a year. I just, same thing, I buy butter that is summer butter, because it's got the richest stuff, and I freeze it and I use it all year long. It's a much better choice.
How about reinforcing sleep? I have bad sleep patterns, and do you have a suggestion on the kinds of food you should eat?
Well, in the Bulletproof diet, there's a couple of recommendations for that. And there's, I'd say, there's three things that can happen for quality sleep, and you just have to test it out. One of them is people run out of energy in the middle of the night. And there's people have a hard time going to sleep, people have a hard time staying asleep. But if you run out of energy sometime between like 3 and 5, you sort of wake up and just wake up. You don't really know why. And it turns out it's because you needed more energy, you didn't have it. So there are people who take maybe up to a tablespoon, maybe a little bit less, of raw honey. Doesn't work with cooked honey. And raw honey raises glycogen in your liver, which is how your body stores carbs, not in the muscles very much. And you want to stay relatively low glycogen in the muscles, but the liver then feeds the brain at night. This actually really helps with morning sickness for people in their pregnant as well. Then there's another group who take collagen before bed, which is pre-digested. So there is no protein digestion going on. It just gets absorbed, and the source of the amino acids for them helps. And both groups may take brain octane oil with it, or some people can take it by itself, because then they're getting fat energy. And in the book, I published some references to studies where we talk about what happens during sleep. At night, your body has to pump cerebrospinal fluid into your brain and wash your brain. Basically, gets rid of all the brain toxins that build up, basically toxic proteins during the day. It's called your glymphatic system. The problem is the glymphatic system is driven by your mitochondria. So if you don't have enough energy in the body, then your mitochondria don't work very well. So if you can turn up your mitochondria efficiency or make sure you have enough of them, that deep sleep restorative thing can happen more efficiently. So you can make sure you have enough fuel in the body to do it. And I also take the unfair advantage supplement that I make before bed because it increases mitochondrial efficiency. So there's other supplements you can do. Even a basic thing like magnesium, for a lot of people, they sleep like babies when they do that. There's amino acids, like GABA, you can take that really make a huge difference. You can take 5-HTP or tryptophan. So there's a lot of low-hanging fruit for people who don't sleep well. But the cheapest thing of all, and the most ghetto thing of all, is aluminum foil. Just tape it over your windows. If you actually have curtains that work, and curtains that work mean when you close them, you actually don't see light. It's amazing. We hired a curtain person when we bought our house. And I'm like, let me just be really quick. The project will be a failure if I can see light when the curtains are closed. And I'm like, because we're buying blackout curtains. She goes, really? They're blackout curtains. What's wrong with this? But here's the deal. If you want to sleep really well, if you live in a city, you're getting weird street lights, which should be banned because they're bad for everyone, including all the bugs and birds and stuff. But you need a dark room. When you have a dark room, no LEDs, tape over the LEDs, better yet, unplug them, and you sleep better. Like, it's free. Turn the thermostat to 68, which is kind of expensive in Mexico, but that helps as well. And so getting a slightly cooler room, perfectly pitch dark, and stop staring at your screen before bed. That screen, when you look at a white light, for 4 hours your body won't make melatonin. So there are things you can do, like you can wear dorky looking orange glasses, which I'm known to do. You also can get a screen protector that filters out the worst of the blue light. That's something I manufacture. It's called the Zentech protector, and that's on the website. And I have one on my phone right now, because you know what? I actually use my phone as my alarm clock. I put an airplane mode so I don't cook myself. It also monitors my sleep quality. But there's a little protector you can't really see that's on the screen that blocks that blue spectrum. So when I look at it to set my alarm clock, I'm not telling myself to get no melatonin. So those are like little sleep hacks. Some are free, some are more or less than free, but they all work great.
Thank you.
Okay, so in the book, you say that your diet should be, if I'm correct, 70% fat and 30% veggies and protein, but mostly veggies. Mm-hmm. So with the butter, you say up to 2 tablespoons per meal. How do you start?
Well,
yeah.
You might want to get
like
some.
How much to start?
It depends on what you've been eating before and
help clean. No carbs.
Oh, so you're doing a high protein diet. So what you want to do is you want to swap protein for fat and probably eat more vegetables than you were eating before, is my guess. So it looks like this. You take a plate, cover it in vegetables, cover those in butter. Put a little piece of really high quality meat on top. Mm-hmm. And like, pretty much, that's like a meal.
But how much butter?
There's this amazing thing called hunger and taste.
So your
body will tell you if you need more butter. And if it does, it tastes like it needs more butter or more salt, you just keep putting them on there until you're satisfied. And that's not a joke. That's how you do it.
I saw that, but I thought.
You're worried about having too much butter?
Yes.
Here's what will happen if you have too much butter. Right. You'll be really, really full, and you'll stop eating because more butter sucks. And if that doesn't work, the first time, if you just ignore those things and you just keep pounding the butter, then you're going to have a really uncomfortable experience in the bathroom, and you'll learn that was too much butter. But the body really regulates. When there aren't things like MSG and anti-nutrients in the food that mess up your hunger signals, you really know. And you know, for lunch today, Robyn took me to a place whose name I don't remember. It was like Body something.
Body Cafe.
I was like Body. Anyway, so I'm like, I'll have 2 orders of guacamole. This is your saving grace in restaurants, unless you carry a stick of butter like I do a lot and a little bottle right after me. You just go there, like, give me the guacamole, hold the chips. And you just take the guacamole and you just shake it right on top of whatever you're eating. And that's your replacement for butter. And it's like $4 for a sizable amount of fat. So you do that, and you'll know if you need 1 or 2 guacamoles like that, because it's not creamy enough. And you'll very quickly develop a sense for it. And if worse comes worse, and you put too much butter on it, you really will just stop eating, and then you'll have leftovers. But it's just about impossible to overeat on butter. It is possible to put so much butter in your Bulletproof coffee and to chug it that you're like, okay, I couldn't digest that. That's why I put about 2 tablespoons in. But I'll tell you, for the first 2 years I was doing Bulletproof coffee, when I was doing the research for the book, it was a little bit scary because no one had done that amount of butter before, and I was like, I'll monitor my blood chemistry and I'll look at the science. The science all supported what I was doing. It was just one of those things where like there's that ancestral knowledge that butter might be bad. And so I was doing like 6 or 8 tablespoons of my coffee. And I was also trying to get 4,000 calories to 4,500 calories a day, because I had this idea that I was gonna go on a super high fat diet and try and gain weight, and I was gonna eat enough weight to gain like 20 pounds a week. And I was only going to gain 2 pounds and say, look, maybe it's not calories in, calories out. What I didn't think I'd do is that I would lose weight on that regimen, and I would feel so good that I would do it for like about 2 years. Yeah. But when I started this out, I was doing so much of this butter, and I craved it, and I digested it, and I used it. And what happens when you go on a high, healthy fat diet, the right kinds of fat, is your cell membranes are made out of fat, your hormones are made out of fat. But it takes a long time. It takes, this is a rough number, there is an actual study on this. Somewhere around 700 days to replace half your cell membranes. Whoa. So if you've been eating canola and soy, or you think just once a week I'll have that fried chicken at that nasty place, that the fried oils, you take a capsule of fish oil that's supposed to help you, a capsule of fried oil is the opposite of the fish oil. You don't want to allow that stuff in your body. So if you're just doing it occasionally, it gets built into your cell membranes. And it probably gives you food cravings and headaches and makes you like get muffin toppy and half a day before and stuff like that. So if you go on a high, clean fat diet, it takes a couple years in order to replace those cell membranes. And what I found is after 2 years, I'm like, I just don't want 6 tablespoons of butter in my coffee anymore. Like 2 is about the normal amount. And I've been stable there for years now. And you'll find that you may just need the fat at the beginning, and that's okay. If you're toxic, when you're exposed to toxic mold or something like that, you may need even more, because then what you do is you're flushing the fat-based toxins, they're called lipophoric toxins. You can be flushing those from your system, and I did a lot of that because I've been exposed to mold a lot of times. To this day, if I'm exposed to mold, what am I going to do right away? I'm going to eat a huge amount of fat, because I would rather that I get that those fat soluble toxins in that fat that I'm going to excrete than I would allow it to get into my nervous system. And I'll take charcoal, and I'll take glutathione, and I'll actually take sugar to speed up my mitochondria so I can have more oxidative metabolism. So people think that's weird, but I'm like, fat and sugar for an acute toxic exposure followed by detox protocols. It works really well, unless your candida goes nuts. I'm sorry.
What kind of sugar?
Organic white sugar. Yeah, not a ton, but if you take a little bit of sugar like that, I'm generally opposed to sugar. I'm using it like pharmaceutically. You get a short burst of oxidative metabolism, which helps your body just get stuff out. You don't like the crash from the sugar later, but who cares? You were crashing from toxic mold exposure. Yes. Or that you ate MSG, or you went to a restaurant and they served you spoiled food that tasted good, and then all of a sudden after the meal, you feel like a zombie, and you're like, oh, I just don't feel very good. And you used to just think, oh, it's just because just one of those days. It's never one of those days. Like, it was your fault. You just don't know what you did. So how are we doing on time, Robyn?
Five more minutes.
Sign some books. All right.
Are you guys ready to be bulletproof?
Yeah.
Great. Hey, Dave, also mention your conference. I forgot to mention that.
Okay, sure. So October 23rd through 25th in LA, we're doing the Bulletproof Conference. This is the third one. Should be about 1,000 people there. And we bring in, should be somewhere around 35 vendors with all kinds of stuff you can experience, things like things you find here that affect your biology, and people who do things that help you sleep better, and just things you can actually touch and feel and play with, as well as about a dozen very high-end speakers about how your brain works, how your body works, and very specifically how you can control it. So if you're interested, bulletproofconference.com. We still have like early bird pricing up, as far as I know. And it's one of those things that isn't a moneymaker for Bulletproof, but I do it once every year and hope that it breaks even, because it's the way for people to experience this. One of the things that I didn't understand when I was younger and really struggling was that you have so much control of your biology, and that there are things that give you a lot of control very quickly, and there are some things that are entirely like free and or unconscious, like having curtains that work. Like, you fix that one time and it's invisible. You're gonna close the curtains anyway, you might as well close curtains that work, and then you get the benefit all the time. So understanding those things is part of that body of knowledge, as well as some of those other things, like, oh, you can do the EWAT system that you'll find here at Santa Fe Sol, where, like, wow, I do that, and it does something to my body that I can never replicate in Mother Nature. Almost all of the really big biohacking technologies that I use in my labs on Vancouver Island, they allow my body to be exposed to things that Mother Nature can't provide. So I have a cryotherapy chamber. It lets me stand in air that's 270 degrees below zero. There's no one on Earth that cold. And if I stood there for more than 3 minutes, I could face death. But if I stand there for 2.5, 3 minutes, and probably 3 minutes wouldn't kill me, but 10 minutes would for sure. And what happens is my body's like, I better get ready for an ice age, which turns on brown fat, turns off inflammation, makes you sleep better, profound changes. Makes you make more collagen, things like that. Well, that's pretty interesting. You can't do that in Mother Nature. You do the EWAT thing here, you breathe super hyper-oxygenated air that's not available anywhere on Earth without technology, and then for 30 seconds, you breathe like unoxygenated air, or at least very low oxygen air, that's also not available anywhere on Earth. So maybe from a brown paper bag if you never took it off. So these are the sorts of things where just by telling your body that the environment is a little bit different than it actually is, for a little bit longer, you can send these huge signals that are like, adapt. So this is part of biohacking. And the other thing is, stop doing the little things that make you weak that don't benefit. Every stress I experience should be a stress that causes improvement. Otherwise, it was wasted stress. Why would I do that? That's my goal. Let's see, there was a question here and then back there.
Well, I don't want to get too long, so I'll just try to put it in a synopsis.
Okay.
I've done a lot of vegetarian, like you talked about. Done raw food for a year.
Me too.
So then I did your Bulletproof this winter, and I ate a lot of grass-fed ribeye and eggs and butter. Didn't lose a lot of weight. Had a great time. And then come spring, all I wanted to do was eat raw vegetarian. Mm. And I did that. And then it hit middle summer, and all I wanted to do was eat cooked vegetarian. And I haven't gotten back to meat. And I just am trying to witness, why am I feeling this way? You know, I don't have an issue about it in terms of virtue or not.
Good.
It's more efficient, and I've always been organic, so that's not an issue.
Okay, good. So you got your organic from town.
So just, do you know anyone that you've worked with that's ever had that kind of, okay, I cannot eat another piece of meat, I cannot eat another egg, you know. And I'm fine with the octane and the Bulletproof coffee.
I have seen that, and it oftentimes comes from eating too much protein.
Probably.
And I did this for a long time, especially when I was first trying to lose this 100 pounds, I would ultra Atkins. And Atkins was like, any kind of fat is okay, and any kind of protein is okay. And so you just load up on protein, and I struggled so much. I had these big steaks, ribeyes every night, and I couldn't pee pink on the ketosis steaks. I was so mad, and I was trying so hard. And I'm like, I'll eat less broccoli, I like broccoli. But it wasn't the broccoli, it was the meat. So I find this is the biggest problem, especially with paleo diets as well, is it's like, God, how much meat do you really need? And you don't need that much meat. You want moderate protein, because excessive protein ages you and it increases cancer risk and it can decrease sleep quality even. So the idea is to hit that sweet spot. So I would suggest that possibly it was a lack of vegetables that was the problem.
Or and just way too much meat, because I eat a ton of green juices and vegetables.
Okay, got it. So
I didn't have this thing of foaming. That
oh,
I was
wow.
Foaming was coming out of my mouth
and
coughing. And as soon as I went raw vegetarian, it disappeared.
You, especially after raw vegan, you probably have low stomach acid. As you get older and older.
I just actually, Robyn gave me.
Betaine HCL?
Yes.
Okay. Betaine HCL can help a lot. And as you go on to a higher fat or higher protein diet, that's a really good thing to do is to take this betaine HCL. When I was first starting to do this, I could take 6 large capsules of it, which normally would cause heartburn, but I just made no stomach acid on my own because I was unhealthy. And as I got healthier and healthier, I still take 3 capsules. Per meal on average. And that helps digest fat, helps digest protein. So if you've been a raw vegan, you actually turn off betaine HCL production pretty heavily. And I've been a raw vegan as well, and it didn't end well for me on that. But that could be part of it, that would, especially with the foaming. Betaine's role is to sterilize your food, but it's also to close the valve at the top of your stomach. So that's pretty important.
And what's it called, betaine?
Betaine, B-E-T-A-I-N-E, and then HCL. It's basically hydrochloric acid for your stomach. I think, Robyn, you carry her?
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Okay. I think we have one more question on the science of books.
Based on that, one of the things you said on your blog that I really liked was drinking high pH water while you're eating.
Oh, yeah. Alkaline water while you're eating is not a good idea. In fact, I remember this was going back to like the late 90s. Alkaline water was just kind of catching on, so I had ordered this thing from Japan. It was like $1,200 for this water filter. And like it arrived, and the instructions were in Korean or something. And it was actually Korean and Japanese, it was weird. But it was called a Modelo. And I turned it on, I said, I'm going to drink my alkaline water. You know, I'm a good biohacker, more must be better. And so I drink my alkaline water, and I'm like, well, it's kind of gross, but I'm like, I can still identify my food when I'm done with it. But I stopped digesting my food. Like, I couldn't break it down. And I didn't know why. It took me like a whole year of like, you know, really uncomfortable digestive problems to realize, well, gee, alkaline water doesn't work very well when you're doing this. So if you are going to use alkaline water, you should use it very carefully. Because another kind of thing that I'll tell you, alkaline springs kill animals.
There's alkaline poisoning.
There's alkaline poisoning.
In the desert, Southwest.
If you're getting only alkaline water, and if there's too much alkaline in it, and I'm not saying alkaline water will kill you, just be really clear on that.
No, but you can do too much of
it. Yes. It's called hyperalkalosis. And in fact, on the Bulletproof diet, one thing I found is that my blood is relative, in fact, it's right on the edge of too alkaline, even though I'm eating an acid-forming diet, according to a lot of these texts. It turns out we have a daily acid-alkaline rhythm. And if you're one of those people who wakes up, I don't know, if you're one of those people who wakes up early in the morning, revving, ready to go, you actually have an early acid spike. And if you wake up later, you have a later acid spike. So acid is one of the things that helps you get out of bed in the morning, basically. So that can help you know when you should have your coffee, because coffee also causes an acid spike and then an alkaline thing afterwards. So when someone says, this coffee's alkaline or acid, sorry, there's a time curve associated with this, and then it's actually both. It depends on how quickly you're going to measure the person after they have it. So what this means is that alkaline water for you, maybe something that if you have it in the morning, it makes you feel like a zombie, you get a headache, and then you need to go to the bathroom really bad. And for you, it may be like, oh my god, it made my whole day. So this is something that's worth experimenting with, but not with food. All right, should we sign some books?
Sounds good.
All right, thank you all so much.